So I start with the disclaimer. I might induce this behavior with the in the audience. So please bear with me. So how do we define pruritus? Pruritus is an unpleasant sensation that causes the desire to scratch. And there can be many reasons, dermatologic, systemic, neurologic, psychogenic, mixed or sometimes cryptogenic. But usually what we are dealing with today is a systemic cause, that too liver related. Cholestatic related, and systemic causes account for 20% of the causes of itching, and usually they present with sleeping disorders, disabled daily activities, depression, and even attempted suicide. So pruritus can be presenting complaint of many liver conditions like intrahepatic cholestasis of pregnancy, many hereditary cholestatic disorders. Acute viral hepatitis with cholestasis, but most of the studies and data is available with respect to primary biliary cirrhosis or primary sclerosing cholangitis or ICP, some data is there, and hereditary and congenital, very limited few data is there. So whatever data I'll be presenting today will be mostly from the data with respect to PBC and PSC, and because they have chronic pruritus rather than the acute conditions like AVH or pregnancy. So first we should understand that there are many compounds that are excreted into the bile that undergo enterohepatic circulation. So liver down to the biliary system, terminal ileum back to the portal circulation to the liver. So this is a very effective system. Whenever there is a block in the outflow of the biliary components, the excreted system, excreted things into the system, what happens is there is only absorption. Excess things in the liver will be transferred into the systemic circulation, systemic blood, and these compounds are known to be causing the cholestasis or itch. And how do we know this? Because the biliary drain through either by endonasal biliary drain or draining through the partial biliary diversion, it can lead to rapid deterioration in the symptoms of itching and again recurs once the drain is removed. So there is something in the system, in the bile system, which is being overflown into the systemic circulation. That is they are the compound that are responsible for formation of itch. And also, how do we know that they are spilled into the systemic circulation? The proof is, like, there is old data showing mass or albumin dialysis will decrease rapidly the itching. So the toxins that are taken out from the blood, they lead to sudden improvement in the symptomatology of itching. So there is something from the bile system which has been spilled into the systemic circulation that has to be, that when removed will decrease the symptoms of itching. So this is the basic concept which we should understand. And so factor X or factors in the circulation, they stimulate either the nerve cells directly or the itching producing cells like mast cells in the skin. They release the substances which again further stimulate the nerve cells leading to the itching. So these are the old theories. First for a couple of slides we'll cover the old theories. So bile salts were the main culprits which were for decades were considered to be the reason behind the onset of itch. But there is enough data and many studies which show poor correlation with the bile acid level and the itch intensity. This is visual analog scale. So there is poor correlation between the serum bile salt levels and the itching. And the second theory, which was very widely popular, was endogenous opioids. Opioids were considered to be inhibiting the pain-taking sensory pathways. So inhibition of pain will lead to increase in the itching tendency, because pain pathway usually inhibits the pruritus pathways. So the answer is not that simple. These are simple answers, but they were wrong. There are many complex pathways. In the last decade, so much data has come up on the pathophysiology of the itching in cholestasis. So this is where we stand recently. There are various mediators, including bile acid leading to the activation of TGR5, LPA. I'll come into detail details of the autotoxin, cytokines, immune cells, and even beyond this. I'll come down to each one of them in. So what happens is the each receptor once activated, they traverse to the unmyelinated C fiber, and through the tarsal root ganglion. In the last decade itself, the separate itch pathway has been identified. Earlier, it was thought that the pain-carrying fibers carry the itch, and recently it has been detected that there is separate pathway to carry the itching sensation. And through the dorsal root ganglion, it crossovers to the opposite side and reaches the thalamus to lead the sensation of pruritus. So there can be many modulators in between the pathway as well, in between the. So the currently accepted theories, two theories are there. First is the TGR5 theory. TGR5 is a G protein related bile acid receptor. This is also called G bile acid receptor, G protein related. So since last decade only this TGR5 has come up into picture. What they have shown is, this is the blue one is the transgenic mice with TGR5, extra expression of TGR5. This red one is the knockout of TGR5. This is wild type. So in subcutaneous intradermal injection of deoxycholic acid will increase the itching sensation. The bile salts lead to itching through TGR extra stimulation, but the sensation is decreased compared to wild type if the mice is knocked out to knockout mice of TGR5. So intradermal injection of bile acid of causes TGR5 dependent itching. Okay, and this has further been in the last decade. So many experiments are done. I'll not go into the details. This is how the TGR5 acts. TGR5 activates protein kinase C, and there is adjacent transmembrane receptor protein. This is activated, and further this leads to influx of calcium channels in the cutaneous afferent neurons, C fibers. This leads to the sensation of itch. Okay. So it is not only bile acids but also other things which can stimulate this TGR5. That's why there is poor correlation with bile acids. So the other things which are shown to influence the TGR5 pathway are neurosteroids, that is pregnenolone sulfate. Serum from the pregnant ladies with cholestasis and without cholestasis, it was shown that the serum from the pregnant ladies, if this is very high with sulfated pregnenolones, they are more likely to develop ICP, that is intrahepatic cholestasis of pregnancy. And there was also elevated levels of autotoxin. I'll come into details in the coming slides. And further, the intradermal injection of this pregnant lady's serum or pregnenolone led to increased itching in the mice models as well. So second theory is autotoxin. Shall I? Yeah. The second theory, which is most popular nowadays, is the autotoxin theory. So as this was initially invented in patients with ICP, intrahepatic cholestasis of pregnancy, it was shown that pregnant ladies without itching and with itching, there was significant raise in the levels of autotoxin in the serum. So later it was also found that cholestatic patients with pruritus due to other causes as well had higher levels of autotoxin in the liver. So, and it was also further shown that autotoxin is very specific for pruritus in cholestasis, because other conditions like dermatology conditions or Hodgkin's lymphoma or other conditions did not have any elevation of autotoxin. It was specifically elevated in the cholestatic diseases of liver, and irrespective of the region of the cholestasis, like PBC, PSC, BRIC, cirrhosis related, or every cause. So the autotoxin activity is specific for pruritus of cholestasis. So what is autotoxin? It is a phosphodiesterase. It is a hydrolase. It hydrolyzes the lysophosphatidylcholine, which is released from the sphingolipids on the cell membrane. And lysophosphatidylcholine, as you can see here, this is one. This choline component is taken away, hydrolyzed by this enzyme. ऑटोटॉक्सिन लीडिंग टू फॉर्मेशन ऑफ लाइसोफॉस्फेटिडिक एसिड. दिस इज अ वेरी इंपॉर्टेंट सब्सटेंस, लाइसोफॉस्फेटिडिक एसिड. सो दिस इज द मेन कल्प्रिट बिहाइंड द एक्टिवेशन ऑफ द इचिंग और प्रुरेटिक सिम्पटम्स. सो इट इज अ पोटेंट सिग्नल मॉलिक्यूल. इट हैज सिक्स रिसेप्टर्स एंड मेनी कंडीशंस, मेनी थेरेप्यूटिक इंटरवेंशंस लाइक इवन बेजरी डाइवर्शंस और मार्स और रिफैम्पिसिन और एनी ट्रीटमेंट वॉट वी यूज, दे आर शोन टू डिक्रीज द ऑटोटॉक्सिन एक्टिविटी पोस्ट ट्रीटमेंट एंड द रिडक्शन इन द ऑटोटॉक्सिन लेवल्स दे सपोर्ट दे कॉरलेट विद द ट्रीटमेंट एफिकेसी ऑफ द प्रोराइटिस. सो ऑटोटॉक्सिन लेवल्स correlate with the level of autotaxin correlates with the level of LPA and vice versa and corresponding to the itching sensitivity. So what is the link between LPA and itch pathway? As you can see here, lysophosphatidic acid, it stimulates the LPA 5 receptor, which is there are 6 receptors. The fifth one is known to be expressed on the nerve endings. LPA5, once stimulated, this activates through this transmembrane receptor protein, activating this one, TRPA1. TRPV1 is for pain signal, A1 is for pruritic signal. So the nerve fibers containing like unmyelinated C fibers of pruritus present on the skin containing TRPA1 will be activated, leading to calcium influx and itching. So LPA is a major mediator of cholestatic pruritus. And higher LPA means higher autotaxin activity. So this is seen in cholestatic conditions.
Autotaxin was involved with the pulmonary fibrosis, and you know, I may be wrong, but autotaxin in the liver patients.
Yes, sir. So most of the data. Most of the data on autotaxin in cholestatic conditions has come up in last 5 to 7 years. Initially described in 2010 by Kramer et al. 2010, published in Gastro, and it was shown that in patients with ICP basically, and in the sera, it was shown that the sera of the patients of ICP stimulates the increases the intracytoplasmic calcium levels and further stimulating the neurons. So in 2010, Gastro Kramer et al. Was the first paper. And further down there is enough data, and it supports that once the itching intensity goes down, autotaxin levels also go down. It is mainly the
there used to be all histamine or C fiber or
yes sir. So this is the C fiber, sir. LPA5 is present on the C fiber, unmyelinated cutaneous fibers, and calcium influx is seen in those fibers only. There is a separate pathway.
Explain again. I'm sorry. I am unable to.
I'll start from the autotoxin.
No,
okay. So initially, the autotoxin was described in the sera of ICP patients with pregnancy, and it was shown that pregnant controls and ICP patients there was significant elevation of the autotoxin levels in the blood. And it was further shown that autotoxin levels were higher in other conditions of cholestatic patients, and especially those with pruritus. And these are the conditions, skin conditions leading to pruritus, there is no elevation of autotoxin. Liver conditions, there is elevation. And liver conditions lead to cholestasis like PBC, PSC, BRIC, PFIC, other liver conditions, they all have elevated autotaxin levels in the serum with a good sensitivity. In fact, it was shown that in pregnancy, if you show a higher level of autotaxin levels, you can predict the future onset of ICP. So it is that sensitive. So autotaxin level is specific for pruritus of cholestasis, not to the other pruritus. And I described autotaxin. How is it formed? Autotaxin is an enzyme, phosphodiesterase 2. And this is not the main culprit. It actually increases the level of LPA. This is the main pruritogen, lysophosphatidic acid. This is the main pruritogen. It is found by hydrolysis of this choline from the lysophosphatidyl choline. Lysophosphatidyl choline is derived from the sphingolipids on the cell membranes. So after hydrolysis, the LPA is produced. This LPA is the strong molecule, and this is a signaling molecule. It has 5-6 receptors. The LPA5, I said, was the main culprit behind the onset of itching. And this is present also on the sea fibers, unmarinated skin fibers. And it was shown that the ototoxin levels improve with the treatment, and in various clinical trials it has been shown that it improves. And as I said, LPA, it acts on the LPA 5 receptors on the nerve fibers, leading to activation of this transmembrane receptor potential, like TRP A1, leading to influx of calcium. This is the main stimulus on the nerve fiber to produce the sensation of itching. You can see here LPA 5 is the most important mediator for the LPA in the nerve fibers. So higher LPA means higher ototoxin activity, and vice versa. And it is the major mediator of cholestatic pruritus. So coming to the age-old therapies for cholestatic itch, I'll just cover them in one slide each, because there is no much recent data, and we know that these drugs are not that effective, and they're difficult to give, and they're difficult to continue on a long-term basis. The first and the only drug which is approved is the cholestyramine. These are the anion exchange resins. They remove the pruritogens from the enterohepatic circulations. In the bowel, they bind to the bile salts and take it away, or maybe other pruritogens as well. Rifampicin, it increases the biotransformation of potential pruritogens, and as well as decreases the CYP7A, that is the major enzyme, rate-limiting enzyme for the bile salt synthesis. So next is the opioid antagonist. They decrease the opioidogenic tone in the nerve fibers, leading to increased pain sensation, or increase in the level of the, or decrease in the threshold of the pain. So once the, like why do we scratch? When we have a itch, why do we scratch? The scratching will induce the pain, it will stimulate the pain fibers, and the pain competitively inhibits the pruritic sensation. So that is how these things act. Other things that are tried is the SSRIs. As I described, you can interrupt the enterohepatic cycle to take out the pruritogens by various mechanisms like nasobiliary drainage, albumin dialysis, mass plasmapheresis, or whatever. So on the novel therapies are PPAR agonist and ASBT or IBAT inhibitors. We'll discuss a little detail about these two mainly. Everything, there is data on albumin dialysis, there is little, but all the data is case series. Albumin dialysis or plasma exchange or mass, everything works. But how long will be, I'll come to one slide, I have made each of them. So as I said, cholestyramine is the only licensed therapy. This is the first line therapy. The main thing is its palatability. It is very bitter and difficult to consume. And as it also binds to other medications what we use, it should be consumed 2 to 4 years after or before the other medicines, especially the UDCA used in PBC. It has limited efficacy in wards. We have seen not many patients will say, I have some very good relief the next day. It's very difficult to convince the patient to consume that bitter item. So the dose is 4 to 6 grams per day. And it has its own side effects as well. And it is not suitable for long-term use. Rifampicin, I said, it is started usually at 150 mg and it can be increased up to 300 mg. There is enough data. Meta-analysis also showing efficacy of rifampicin on pruritus. There is 10% risk of hepatotoxicity, and there can be prolongation of INR and as well as some hemolysis. So we should monitor the patients regularly for transaminitis, and definitely it is not suitable for long-term management of cholestatic liver diseases. This is a second-line therapy with limited efficacy. I told about opioids. Usually the naltrexone is the drug used. Again, it has its own side effects and difficult to give for long time. Beyond months or couple of months, it is difficult to continue them. It can have its own opioid withdrawal symptoms and long-term tolerability, and there can be reduced threshold for the pain and other things. So it is difficult to give it for a long, although it has limited efficacy. Other drugs, sertraline has been used. One double-blind RCT has shown 75 to 100 mg of sertraline, although we don't use it regularly. It can also be tried. Other drugs which are not recommended or not shown to be of any use is UDCA. UDCA is useful only in ICP, and in other conditions it has been shown that UDCA has no benefit, but they can just be used as adjuvants, like even antihistaminics or gabapentin. They can be used as adjuvants with no data or no support. Of course, the liver transplantation helps. This is a 1 year follow-up of liver transplantation in patients with cholestatic liver diseases. You can see the pruritus had decreased significantly from baseline, and the improvement started immediately after the. But these are the extreme situations, the liver dialysis and other things. And so far, what we have covered is the drugs which are effective are cholestyramine binder, rifampicin, enzyme inducer, and nasobiliary drainage or albumin dialysis or plasmapheresis, naltrexone or sertraline on each neuron. This is what we have been practicing for decades, and currently in the last decade, things that have come up which are really interesting, recent updates. One is fibrates, second is apical sodium dependent bile transporter or ileal bile acid transporter. Both are same. ASBT and IBAT, they are synonyms. So this is the first old paper which I could get across in the literature. So initial descriptions were basically incidental. Bezafibrate was shown to decrease alkaline phosphatase and gamma GT by about 30%. It was used in patients with PBC, not used for pruritus. It was just used in PBC patients and shown to improve alkaline phosphatase and gamma GT. 87, this is the first literature. And further in the recent, in 2014, it was shown that this was reconfirmed in many studies, at least 25% reduction in the alkaline phosphatase with the use of bezafibrate was shown. And again, you can see here, after the discontinuation, the alkaline phosphatase again went up. The improvement was only as long as the medicine was given. And again, if you start it can come down. How does it act? It is a pan agonist of PPAR. I'll come to that in little detail. PPAR is the peroxisome proliferator activated receptor. These are very important from the hepatology perspective. There are only four agonists of PPARs. One is free fatty acids. Second is glitazars, saroglitazar, what we use. Glitazones, pioglitazone and other things what we were using. And the fourth one is fibrates. These are the only four agonists which can stimulate the PPARs. There are three PPARs which are known, PPAR alpha, beta delta, and PPAR gamma. Liver expresses mainly alpha and beta delta. Delta is beta delta. Gamma is present in the adipose tissue. That's why pioglitazone increases the adiposity in the peripheral tissue. Obesity and other side effects of pioglitazones were due to delta. So alpha and were due to gamma. Alpha and delta are mainly expressed in liver. Okay. So what do they do? PPRs are involved in how do we understand this? PPR works in tandem with FXR, like they agonize each other. FXR and PPR, their functions are almost similar. So we can conceptualize in that way. They export the triglycerides from the liver, so decrease the hepatic fat. They increase the beta oxidation. PPRs increase the beta oxidation of the fatty acids, so their target is to decrease the fatty acid content in the hepatocyte, and they export the triglycerides from the hepatocyte, lead to VLDL formation, and also increase the HDL levels in the serum by taking out the cholesterol esters. Thirdly, they modulate bile acid concentration in various ways, along with FXR as well. The PPARs, as you can see here, will inhibit the CYP7A1, the rate-limiting enzyme in the bile salt synthesis, bile acid synthesis. They increase bile acid detoxification by increasing the conjugation or glucuronidation or sulfation of the bile acids, and thus help increase the detoxification of the bile acids. They also inhibit, as you can see, they can inhibit the NTCP, the receptor for the bile acids uptake from the hepatocytes, mainly on the sinusoidal membrane. The NTCP receptor is inhibited by the PPARs, so the bile acid influx into the hepatocytes is reduced. Also, the PPRs increase the level of MDR3, multi-drug resistant protein, which is important in the export of mainly phospholipids and increased bile acid solubility and export into the bile ducts. So the main concept is they work in tandem with the FXR. FXR also does many of the same things. So similarly, their work is to decrease the bile acid concentration within the hepatocyte. So hepatocytes are one of the strongest obnoxious substances in the body. So hepatocyte doesn't want it to be inside them. They want it always in the circulation. So whenever there is an obstruction, increased bile acids in the portal circulation, they want to avoid access into the hepatocytes. That is the mechanism basically. So PPRs do all these things. They modulate the bile acid levels. Additionally, they also have inhibitory effect on NF-kappa-B, lead to anti-inflammation, and some effect on fibrosis is also shown in the literature. So these are the main effects by which the fibrates or pan agonists of PPARs, they act, increase the beta oxidation, export the triglycerides, they modulate bile acids, and they are also anti-inflammatory. There are various trials, I will not describe each trial, this is the mechanism. So they are primarily anti-cholestatic, anti-inflammatory, anti-fibrotic. So this is the initial Spanish study in which they used bezafibrate in the cholestatic pruritus. This is AMJ 2017. What they could show was the alkaline phosphatase levels decreased, that's though, but 26 of these 48 had pruritus, out of which 16 patients had resolution of pruritus and 7 had improvement. Only 3 remain unchanged. This was on the follow-up of 48 weeks. So more than 1 year follow-up of bezafibrate decreased the symptoms of pruritus. This was the first paper, Spanish trial, showing efficacy of fibrates on pruritus. So next, there is this NEJM paper in 2018. This is famous as the Bezurso trial. In this study, primary endpoint was not pruritus. It was a complete biochemical response in patients with PBC. And what they showed was, primary endpoint in this trial was a complete biochemical response. They included PBC patients who were not responding to UDCA, not biochemically responding to long-term UDCA. So the UDCA was continued and they added the bezafibrate at a dose of 400 mg per day. So what they could see was definitely there was around 67% of the patients showed normalization of alkaline phosphatase who were not responding initially to the URSO. And in the basic drawback in the trial was their basal VAS score, visual analog score for pruritus, were little lower, around 2. But in the post hoc analysis in the Bezuso trial, they also showed significant improvement in the pruritus or itch severity score, visual analog score severity, over 2 year follow up. So the orange ones are the bezafibrate. There was significant lower itching intensity in the bezafibrate received limb of the pruritic patients in this group. So this was, we should remember that the primary outcome was not meant for this. This was just a post hoc analysis. So what they did further, they started this, I discussed this. This is the post hoc analysis. Again, it also showed that anti-pruritic effect of bezafibrate in PBC was independent of autotoxin. Autotoxin levels remained unchanged in this group, but still they had improvement in the pruritus. This works in a different pathway other than autotoxin. And so later what they did was have done this double blind RCT. This is Fitch trial. This is accepted, not yet published. December accepted in the gastroenterology. This is a very good study. I will discuss a little in detail. The primary endpoint of this trial is more than 50% improvement in the visual analog scale of itch intensity. So this is the first double blind trial concerning cholestatic pruritus using fibrates. So the basal itch intensity was more than 5. That means all the patients had severe intensity of pruritus. And they included patients of PBC, PSC, and secondary sclerosing cholangitis. And they validated itch intensity by three methods. I will not go into details. And one more thing was they gave the medicine only for 21 days. and the analysis was done at 21 day and 35th day after stopping of it. And the dose again was 400 mg OD versus placebo, 21 days. These are the results. More than 50% reduction in the VAS score was the primary endpoint. It was seen in 45% of the patients who received bezafibrate versus only 11% in the placebo limb, which is very significant. And in the subgroup analysis, both the PSC and PBC patients had improvement in the itching score. And also you can see here, the pruritus intensity decreased continuously till 21 day, and after the stoppage of fibrates, it went up again. So the benefit was only as long as the bezafibrate was given. And there were other secondary endpoints. It also improved morning itching, evening itching, and all other secondary endpoints. Like, there was improvement, of course, in the alkaline phosphatase, which is known since long time. Autotaxin activity, there is no relation again. There is no relation between the autotaxin and the fibrate efficacy or the bile acid levels. There is no correlation. So it works, the fibrates work in a different way than the like different pathway other than bile salts or autotaxin. Maybe substance X, we are not sure of it, what it reduces. So there are some concerns with the use of fibrates, and around 6% of the patients develop transaminitis. So we need to monitor their LFTs frequently. And in the Bezoso trial, there was no, they included the patients with creatinine up to 2, but here in the Fitch trial, they included patients with creatinine up to 1.5. Because what is known is that fibrates are known to increase the creatinine levels by 5%. So the EGFR of less than 60 ml was not included here, although the drug literature says that up to 40 ml EGFR fibrates are safe. You can use it. There is some concern on the creatinine. We should monitor. That's the message. Non-severe myalgias. Many, and one more thing is, only 45% responded in the Fitch trial. That means to say 55% still did not respond. So possibly the duration of therapy was less, or the mechanisms were different. And maybe the combination with other drugs can also be tried. So coming to the next drug, next target, ileal bile acid transporter, IBAT inhibitors, or apical sodium dependent bile acid transporters. Both are synonyms, both correspond to the same thing. What they do basically, and the terminal ileum where the ASBT is present, they block this ASBT so that there is more bile acid in the colon. They are excreted away and not taken up into the enterohepatic circulation. That is what the ASBT inhibition does, and so that the portal bile salt level or the systemic bile salt levels go down. That is how they work through decreasing the bile salt levels. There are many phase 1, phase 2A, phase 2B trials ongoing in the last 3 years. If the time permits, I'll describe the pathway here. Bile acids, this is the terminal ileal enterocyte. Through the ASBT, they enter the enterocytes. In the enterocyte, they bind to ileal bile acid binding protein. So through this, it is transported across into organic solute transporter along the basolateral side of the enterocyte, ileal enterocyte. And from there, it enters the portal circulation, then taken up by the bile acids are taken up, as I told earlier, by the ATCP or OATP, organic acid transport protein, peptides, polypeptide. In the hepatocyte, they are again conjugated and exported into the bile canalically through the bile salt export protein. This is the enterohepatic circulation. They again circles again. So along with that, both in the enterocyte and in the hepatocyte, bile acids also activate the FXR. What FXR's function is to limit the amount of bile acid in the systemic circulation. So FXR also stimulates this FGF19 in the enterocyte, ileal enterocyte. This FGF19 again inhibits, goes into the portal circulation and inhibits the bile salt synthesis, bile acid synthesis in the hepatocytes, and as well as bile acids in the hepatocytes improve the FXR. They activate the FXR active gene transcription, leading to inhibition of the bile acid synthesis. So function of FXR and SGF is to limit the excess bile acids in the blood. Yes, both are. In the enterocyte, the FXR increases the FGF19. So this FGF19, the function is to go into the portal circulation to the liver and inhibit the CYP7A. So decreasing the bile acid synthesis. So there are two sensors, one at the enterocyte level, one in the hepatocyte level, FXRs. Their job is to control the level of bile acid synthesis and bile acid pool. Negative. I'll skip this slide. Many early trials had shown that there is improved pruritus in patients with who received bile salt, the IBAT in antagonist. And this is the early study, phase 2A, in patients with PBC with pruritus. I wanted to discuss only on the... this is a pediatric study. They had all the pediatric group, like PFIC and Allergil and all. I have made one slide on the pediatric. I'll show that slide. So this is a phase 2A trial in 2017, published in Lancet, quoted everywhere. 22 patients of PBC with pruritus. The IBAT inhibitor, this is GSK672. Nowadays it is called IBAT. So this was a crossover trial. What they saw was there was at least 50% improvement in the itching scores after 14 days of IBAT inhibitor compared to the placebo. In addition, there was also around 50% decrease in the bile acid levels in the same group. As well, there was increase in the fecal levels of bile acid or bile salts, primary and secondary bile salts. The main side effect, as we can presume, it is diarrhea, because there are more bile acids or bile salts in the colon. So diarrhea was seen in around 33%, but it lasted for only 4 days. And they say no one required drug discontinuation because of diarrhea. But still, it was just a 14-day trial. Long-term efficacy or side effect profile are yet to be known. And they also showed an improvement in the autotaxin levels. So the IBAT inhibitors work through the bile acids and the autotaxin. This is a couple of other studies which showed similar efficacies. This is the pediatric trial published in the ASLD abstracts. Children with cholestatic liver disease and pruritus, PFIC, allergic bile acid, and intrahepatic cholestasis. They showed absolute decrease in the pruritus with A4250. This is again an IBAT inhibitor, and it was seen in all the patients of pediatric cholestasis related itching. Again, the side effects were bloating, diarrhea, dose dependent. This is one more. This was a late breaker in the last ASLD Glimmer study. There is a glimmer of hope with the use of IBATs. So dose response, this was mainly phase 2B dose response study. They have used 6 levels of doses, but what over 12 weeks of treatment with the IBAT inhibitor, again the same drug GSK672. What they saw was this Lanerix IBAT at a doses of 40 mg BD or 90 mg BD or 180 mg OD compared to placebo had significant improvement in the itching score over 12 weeks of treatment. This was a double blind randomized controlled trial. Of course, diarrhea was again the, and diarrhea and abdominal pain were again the common complaints. But this is the phase 2B, yet to be published. It was just a late breaker effect in the liver meat. So this is all the data that we have on IBATs. So I end my presentation here with summarizing that currently approved treatments of cholestatic itch are suboptimal, and we definitely need more newer and more effective, safer, long-term usable medicines. So possibly PPAR agonists like fibrates or ASBT seem promising. We need more data in the real clinical scenario. And in extreme situations, definitely biliary diversion, apheresis, albumin dialysis, or liver transplantation, they continue to remain. But we need more effective and safe, more conservative treatment options, and which will be available in the near future. So happiness is having a scratch for all the itches. So that's it. Thank you.